Church, I mean, this is the best day ever. This is Easter, and He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Guys, we are here today because of Easter, not because of baskets and bunnies and eggs. We are here because Jesus has risen. We have this faith because He rose from the grave and He defeated death for us. And that's what our whole theme is about, upside down. Guys, imagine what Jesus did for us. Oh my goodness. I mean, Jesus is God, He is King, and He totally put us before Himself by dying on the cross, and it didn't end there though. In victory, He rose from the grave, and it's amazing, and there's nobody else who's ever done that. That's why we are here today, and we believe Him with all of our heart, and you're going to hear more about that today, and I'm all psyched up, so now I really got a big question for you, because you better be ready today, y'all. It is Easter, and we are following the most victorious warrior, Jesus. How incredible. All right, here it goes. Everybody ready out there? My staff, yeah? Are you ready?
Always ready!
Yes, they are ready, and I know you guys are ready too. And before we get into our scripture of the month, want to know if it is your birthday. If you had a birthday this week, stand up and do a little shake. Go get a hat if you need to. Totally fine if you need to go get a hat. And we will make sure to sing you a big old happy birthday when you come back here. All right, guys, so let's talk really quickly about our scripture. It should be up behind me. We talked about this last week. It is all about humility, and you've been learning about this word humility, about really putting others before yourself, just like Jesus did. So let's do our scripture. So shake your head and say, don't do anything only to get ahead. So don't do anything only to get ahead. Don't do it because you are proud. Don't do it because you are proud. Instead, be humble. Instead, be humble. And value others more than yourself. Just like Jesus did. He valued us more than Himself by dying on that cross. Guys, that's in Philippians 2:3. I want you to shout it to the ends of the earth. Shout that in your living room. Let's do it one more time. Don't do anything only to get ahead. Don't do it because you are proud. Instead, be humble. Value others more than yourself. All right, guys, we're going to watch a video, so stay tuned.
Hey, everybody. It's me, Jacob. But you can call me Jake, because, well, that's what everybody calls me. Happy Easter! Wait a second. Am I upside down or are you? I know what's happening. Somebody's playing an April Fool's Month joke on old Jakey. Well, you got me. All right. There we go. So today, I'm going to talk about humility. Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. Easter is the perfect time to talk about humility because it's the day that Jesus totally gave up what He deserved when He... Oh! Ow! Okay. All right, neck. It's you and me now. All right, that's fine. You wanna play? Let's play. Necks are not supposed to bend that way, but I'm back to normal now. At least my neck is, but the picture's still just a little, I mean, if it could just, we're not doing that again. You know something? So what if I'm upside down? I'm not gonna let this keep me from celebrating the most amazing event in history. And no, I'm not talking about the time I learned how to juggle. I'm talking about the time when God did something so brain-boggling, it turned the whole world upside down. At least it turned my whole world upside down. My brain is still boggling. I'm boggling all over. You'll hear all about it in today's story. But first, I've got to figure out how to get my whole world from upside down to right side up. Hey, okay. Some brain ideas. What if you turned your screen upside down? That shouldn't be too hard, right? Or maybe there's a better way. Stay tuned.
All right, guys and gals, it's time to stand up. We're going to praise our risen Lord and Savior. It is Easter Sunday. In the church where I grew up, we start that morning with, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let's try that one more time. Your job is to say, He is risen indeed, with as much joy as you can muster. Here we go. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Much better. Awesome work. We are going to sing a song about a God who is not dead, He is alive.
Living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside.
Happy Easter, boys and girls. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Last week's story, if you remember, Jesus was arrested. Judas betrayed him. During this Easter week, Jesus has been crucified. He's been had more things happen to him than we can ever imagine. Our story is coming up, and it's going to talk to you about what happened to Jesus and the big story.
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story, inspired by the book of John, chapters 18 through 20.
For months, the Jewish religious leaders had been making plans to silence Jesus. The things he said and did challenged the way they had always lived. He was upsetting the world as they knew it.
It is better if one man dies for the people than if the whole nation is destroyed.
Then one of Jesus' closest friends, Judas, betrayed to the religious leaders where Jesus would be praying after the Passover meal. The leaders sent soldiers to arrest Jesus, and he allowed the mob to take him.
Do you think I can't ask my Father for help? He would send an army of angels. But then how would the scriptures come true? They say it must happen in this way.
As Jesus was tied up and led away, Jesus' closest friends scattered, though Peter and John followed at a distance. What was it like for them? Try to imagine for a minute that you're Peter. Only hours before, Jesus told you,
"Before the rooster crows, you will say three times that you don't know me."
And you, Peter, protested that you would die before deserting. But now Jesus has been arrested, and if you get too close, they might take you too. So you trail along like a stray dog as soldiers haul Jesus inside the home of the high priest.
What's happening in there?
The servant at the door frowns as she peers at you.
You aren't one of Jesus' disciples, are you?
I am not.
You're ashamed to lie, but what good will you be to Jesus if you get arrested too? You huddle close to the fire in the courtyard as voices float through a high-up window.
What's this foolishness you've been teaching?
I didn't say anything in secret. Ask the people who heard me. They certainly know what I said.
You feel sick. Now they've taken Jesus. You know nothing will stop them. Someone else asks whether you're one of Jesus' followers, and you snap.
No, I'm not.
Minutes later, another man asks whether he saw you in Gethsemane with Jesus. Your stomach churns.
Nope, not me.
You realize you have denied Jesus three times, just as he said, and all you can do is stagger to your feet and run away, weeping. Now, imagine you're John instead of Peter. Somewhere in the chaos, you've lost Peter. So when soldiers haul Jesus away to the Roman governor, all you can do is follow, alone. From the back of the crowd, you witness the terrible drama as the governor Pilate brings Jesus out.
What charges are you bringing against this man?
He has committed crimes.
Pilate takes Jesus away for questioning. You can only pray that he sees through all the lies and stops this madness. You're horrified when Pilate brought Jesus out again, battered and bruised.
I find no basis for a charge against him.
No, crucify him!
Crucify him!
Pilate hands Jesus over to the soldiers, who force him to carry the heavy beams of his own rough cross. You know where they are going.
Golgotha.
It's a hill outside the city. As in a bad dream, you force yourself to follow. Along the dusty road, you find Jesus' mother, Mary, her sister, and Mary Magdalene. None of you can speak. You arrive at Golgotha in time to see soldiers nail Jesus to the wooden bars with heavy spikes and raise the cross up high. You strain your eyes to read the sign placed above Jesus' head.
K
King of the Jews.
You nearly choke on dust and grit. You've seen Jesus do amazing, powerful things, and yet he's allowed himself to be taken and battered. You glance over and see Mary sobbing, so you place your hand on her shoulder. When you look back up, you see Jesus watching his mother through the pain in his eyes.
Dear woman, here is your son.
Jesus looks directly at you, eyes filled with love.
Here is your mother.
Yes, Lord.
You are overwhelmed to know that Jesus trusts you to take care of his own mother. But the terrible truth sinks in. Jesus knows that he will die. He's planning on it, just as he's been saying for weeks. A short time later, you see him lift his gaze to heaven.
It is finished.
Then he bows his head, and you can see the life leave his body. All the air seems to leave your own lungs, too. You thought Jesus was God's chosen one. How could he be dead? Now, as we move ahead, imagine you're Mary Magdalene, one of Jesus's close followers. Unlike so many others, you've dared to stay there, at the cross. And once Jesus is dead, you dare to follow the men who take his body for burial, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus.
A garden tomb.
The evening has faded, and it's now the Sabbath. You want to honor Jesus by anointing his body with spices, but it will have to wait until the Sabbath is over. So you stay hidden indoors until early Sunday morning, then you make your way through the dark streets.
The stone. What will I do about the stone?
As you arrive, you recall that a heavy stone was rolled to block the entrance of the tomb, but now...
it's gone!
You gasp as you peer inside the tomb. Gray light reveals.
It's empty!
Heart pounding, you race back through the streets to the home where the disciples are staying.
They have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they have put him.
You can see the shock in Peter's face. John gapes, and then they both begin to run to see for themselves. At a loss, you follow slowly, weighed down with exhaustion and confusion. When you reach the garden, you see Peter and John ahead, trying to make sense of it. You hang back as they leave again.
What more is there to say?
As the first rays of dawn light up the garden, you reach the tomb. Tears spill down your face as you bend to look inside once more. Two figures in radiant white sit where Jesus's body lay. You can't even begin to think what this means.
Woman, why are you crying?
They have taken my Lord away. I don't know where they've put him.
You turn away to catch your breath and find another man standing right there. At first you think Peter or John has returned, but it's not one of them. Maybe it's a gardener.
Woman, why are you crying? Who are you looking for?
Sir, did you carry him away? Tell me where you put him, then I will go and get him.
Mary.
The moment he speaks your name, you see, you understand. It's Jesus.
Teacher!
You fling yourself at his feet because there isn't anything else you can do. Gently, he touches your shoulder.
Do not hold on to me. I have not yet ascended to the Father. Instead, go to those who believe in me. Tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.
You rise to your feet, still weeping, but your tears are full of joy. You start to run again because you can't wait one second more to deliver the news.
I have seen the Lord.
Jesus chose to face death for those he loved, and now he's defeated it. Jesus is alive. It's the best news ever for everyone across all time.
I don't know about you, but every time I hear the Easter story, my brain literally explodes. Well, not like literally. I mean like figuratively literally. Seriously, think about it.
When God made the first two people ever, he told them if they ever ate fruit from the bad tree, they would surely die. Well, they did it anyway, and they died, and they stayed dead. because that's how death was supposed to work. So did everyone who came after them. Abraham died, Moses, all these people died and they stayed dead because that's how death was supposed to work. But then came Jesus. When Jesus died, everyone thought he was gonna stay dead too. But God can do stuff that nobody else can do. So he rolled away the stone and brought his son back to life. I'm getting lightheaded just thinking about it. Jesus is so strong, not even death can stop him. So it's kind of like everything's upside down in this story too. Jesus dying when he didn't do anything wrong is upside down. Jesus coming back from the dead is upside down. Even I'm upside down. Whoa, all right, okay. I'm gonna get back up now. I'm getting really lightheaded. Oh. Here's the one thing to remember today. Jesus put us first. Jesus died on the cross so me and you can have a relationship with God that lasts forever. And Jesus rose again to show that there's literally nothing he can't do. Literally, literally. So, you should definitely put your faith in Jesus if you haven't already. Ask someone you trust if there's anything you don't understand. That's what I'd do. In fact, does anyone understand how to make a video turn right side up again? I mean, I've tried everything. Wait a second. My phone's upside down. My phone was upside down the whole time. Ugh, classic Jakey.
Wasn't that a great story, boys and girls? Jesus died on the cross. He paid for our sins, my sins, your sins. And guess what? Jesus is alive. Jesus is going to appear to his disciples many more times to prove that he had truly risen from the dead. I hope you guys have a great Easter with your family and have a great week.
Hey, kids. Easter week. Oh, my goodness. You know, I love Christmas. Christmas is probably my favorite holiday. But Easter is the one that we should all be thankful for. That's the week that our Savior made the choice to allow himself to be hung on a cross and to die for us. We get the gifts at Christmas. We unwrap all the presents and get all excited. But today's the day we should be excited. Resurrection Sunday. The day that Jesus gave his life for us. For you. Not just for me. Not for the whole world. But for you. Wherever you're listening. In your living room, in your den, in your kitchen, in your bedroom, maybe even in your car. Maybe on the playground. Maybe you and your parents are sitting on a playground, swinging on a swing, and you're watching this video right now. Jesus loves you. And he proved his love. He turned the world upside down for you so that you could go to heaven. He didn't do it for him. He already had a home in heaven. In fact, he left that home in heaven to come here for you. It would be a shame for Jesus to have made that sacrifice, for him to have humbled himself and died on a cross for you, and you say, no, thank you. Don't need it. Boys and girls, today I just pray that if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, that you would say these three things to him. I know I'm a sinner. I believe you died on the cross for me. And ask him to forgive your sins. Because he will. He says he will. And I believe that. He'll forgive your sins, and from then on, you can know for sure, with 100% certainty, that you're going to heaven. But two, boys and girls, the thing I don't want you to miss is you can live an abundant life here on earth. My life since I accepted Jesus has been so much better, and he wants to give you that too. So think about it. Pray about it. Let's pray right now, just me and you and everybody else that's watching, but just me and you, let's just pray, and let's talk to God. Dear Jesus, thank you so much that you gave yourself for me, that you gave yourself to each one of the boys and girls that are watching this. And I pray that wherever they're at, that you would touch them in such a way that they couldn't help but to ask for your love and your forgiveness. And Father, just a prayer for the rest of us too that do know you and have accepted you as our Savior. Father, I pray that we would be joyful and we would tell others about you and we would live our life the way you want us to. Help us turn the world upside down too. Help us turn the world upside down by telling other people about you. Father God, we love you so much and we're so thankful that you gave your life so that we could have life. Touch our hearts today, Father. We love you, we thank you, and in your name we pray these things. Amen. Boys and girls, we miss y'all so bad. Sitting here getting misty-eyed just thinking about not being here with you. But we can't wait to see you. But until we do, remember, studio252.tv, studio252.tv. There's a lot of other videos that you can see that go along with our lessons. There's some activities that you and your family can do together or that you can do by yourself. And also, one last thing, you know we always ask during our offering time if you have questions, praise reports, prayer requests. We would like to hear those still too. So if you would, just jot those down in an email. Maybe you need to get Mom and Dad to send it to us. But send it to me at rick@life-community.com. And I promise you, any question you send me, any prayer request, any praise report that you send me, I will send it out in an email to all of the Sunday school teachers and all of our kids' church staff. We love you, we care for you, and we can't wait to see you again. Have a great rest of your Easter holiday, boys and girls. Love you. Bye.
Let's do church clap, guys. Get out of here.
Coming back.